AMD's Radeon RX 5000 series graphics cards have been out for a while now. Have they gotten any better since launch? Are they now worthy of your hard-earned cash? Let's find out.
做什么?
Wait, shooting lah.
Oh, sorry.
With the Radeon RX 5000 series graphics card, AMD definitely took a step towards the right direction to regain market share as well as consumer confidence. While the hardware sure is impressive, drivers, to put things mildly, still left a lot to be desired. Regardless, these new graphics cards did present us with competitive raw graphics performance in gaming with excellent value, although they were pretty much overshadowed by the competitors' fancy features. When the RX 5700 XT first launched, users were reporting issues such as monitor problems, black screen and other bugs. While I have not experienced any major complications in gaming, working with software such as Premiere Pro did present some stability concerns. To AMD's credit, they have been consistently pushing out driver updates. And today we're going to revisit the 5500 XT, the 5600 XT and the 5700 XT to see if they have improved as graphics cards for performance in gaming and content creation, especially now that Adobe has enabled hardware encoding for their Premiere Pro. Why did we choose these three cards? Well, they are currently AMD's best offerings when it comes to three different price points: the RM1000 sub-1000 range, the 1500 ringgit range, and the 2000 ringgit range. Full disclosure, this video is sponsored by AMD, but we do reserve our right to an unbiased opinion, and also numbers don't lie. With that out of the way, let's move on to the benchmarks. Benchmarks. For the benchmarks, we tested all three AMD cards against three cards from the green team: the 1660 Super, 2060 Super, and 2070 Super. I know that the 5500 XT should technically be compared to the 1650 Super, but I don't have one, so yeah. Let's take a look at the benchmarks. For the test bench, we are running a Ryzen 5600 XT on an ASRock X570 Tai Chi with 32GB of Geo Superloose DDR4 RAM rated at 200MHz and the Aorus PCIe Gen 4 NVMe SSD. For the purposes of our testing, this should be just nice. Firstly, we have synthetic benchmarks, and to kick things off, we have 3D Mark times by Extreme. As expected, the 5700 XT sits between the 2060 Super and 2070 Super. The 5600 XT beats the 1660 Super by quite a margin, and the 5500 XT performs reasonably well for the price. In Unigine superposition, while the 5700 XT lost to the 2060 Super, the 5600 XT beat the 1660 Super by quite a bit, with the 5500 XT closely behind. Next, gaming benchmarks. We tested Shadow of Tomb Raider at 1080p and 1440p on the highest settings. Please note that we did turn off DLSS to get raw performance numbers from the cards, so pay that in mind. Once again, the 5700 XT performs better than the 2060 Super, but got impressively close to the 2070 Super, considering the 700 ringgit price difference. Of course, you will get better performance with DLSS on, but it only works on modern titles, and AMD is definitely no slouch in the raw performance department. Next, we have Post Laju Malaysia, which is Death Stranding, a good example of driver optimization by AMD. AMD released a driver in July that supposedly increased performance in Death Stranding by 8% on the 5700 XT, and it definitely shows. The 5700 XT performed neck and neck with the 2070 Super, even beating it in 1440p. To further mix things up, we turned on DLSS for Nvidia cards, and here's what we got. AMD definitely scored a few points here. Finally, real-world benchmarks. And for this test, we rendered out a 4K project we did earlier in Premiere Pro. For those who are unaware, Adobe finally announced hardware encoding support a few months ago for not only Nvidia but also AMD cards as well. Looking at the results though, it's clear that CUDA is still better optimized compared to AMD's OpenCL-based acceleration. But at least now you can use your AMD graphics card to render videos faster, and we expect more improvements to come, especially with their RDNA2-based cards coming soon. As for power consumption on load, AMD cards generally did better thanks to the more efficient 7nm process, but it's still not too big of a difference. Same goes with maximum temperatures, hovering around 60 to 70 Celsius on our open bench. Your mileage may vary because different cards have different cooling systems and fan curves, also your case airflow could be different, and your case size and all that good stuff. So the drivers have definitely improved things quite a bit when it comes to gaming performance as well as stability. We have yet to encounter any major issues during testing, so touch wood. When it comes to hardware encoding in Premiere Pro, the competition still pulls quite a bit ahead. However, Premiere Pro is not the only editing software out there. We also have DaVinci Resolve, which is getting more and more popular and is free. But we didn't do any benchmark with that software because we are still quite noob at it. From my user experience though, these cards perform quite similar to the 1660 Super and the 2060 Super, so kudos. The conclusion is that these three cards are actually very good when it comes to price to performance ratio, especially in gaming. When it comes to gaming PC, I don't see why you shouldn't consider them, okay? For Premiere Pro, they are a little bit more lousier than the competition, but they still work with hardware encoding, so there's that. Okay, my favorite card is actually the 5600 XT because I think that it gives you the best bang for your buck, money for your luck. And it's very cheap at 1300 ringgit, which is so cheap, boy!